Use headphones for best experience. Thanks for your fantastic support. Hi. Say Antarctis. It's quite strange word to say if you speak Swedish. At least I remember when I was a kid, I probably thought it would be Antarktiskt. Antarktiskt. That's more like an adjective. So I think it's a word, but you don't use it so often. But I mean, adjectives in Sweden quite often ends with the iskt, and words ending with I, just is, that's not so common, I guess. But Antarktiskt, that would be if you say the climate is very Antarctic here. Then you would say in Swedish, klimatet är väldigt antarktiskt. Antarktiskt. But that's not what it's called. It's called Antarktis. Or Antarctica. But I'll start with the coast line of Antarctica. Something like this. So it's very confusing about the west and east directions here, close to the South Pole. But this is actually called East Antarctica. Antarctica. And the Antarctic Peninsula. Thank you. start from here. The south pole should be shades of blue here. But actually, the coastline is not the only. I mean the coast of the land, of the continent. It's actually the coastline of the ice shelves. They're quite important as well. Maybe I should have these in mind. I would say it's ice here as well, especially in the Antarctic winter season. The sea ice. I think I read somewhere that the ice doubled in size during the winter. That ice is then melting in the summer. It's not the case with the ice shelves. drums are really, really thick layers of ice, and they're actually moving. So there are some stations, research stations, that's built on these shelves. They're built on the shelves, and then I guess they have to take it down and rebuild it after a couple of years because it has moved from its original location. So here you can see. I wonder what color I would use for those. I think I will use a lot of gray colors for this continent. Let's start with this one. So here's the Ross Ice Shelf, biggest. Here's the Ronnie Ice Shelf, second biggest. It's connected with the Filchner Ice Shelf, so sometimes it's called the Ronnie Filchner Ice Shelf. And maybe this one. Oops. And the next color, perhaps this one, light color. Thank you. see what shades I can use. Maybe this one. This continent is really beautiful. When you look at the satellite image, for example. But I'm not sure I want to go there. Introduce some colder gray now. Maybe this. This is almost blue gray. So C5. See if we have a C2. some mountains. There's a mountain range. Crossing the entire continent, so it's the Transantarctic Mountains. And there are some mountains as well. Mountain peak, the Vinson, Mount Vinson. Here's one. Let's point out some research stations around this continent. We can choose blue color for that. So we have the biggest of these. It's a McMurdo station on Ross Island. It's located somewhere here, and just next to it is the Scott base, and then we have the Dumont Dual Field, French base here. And Australian base. Here somewhere, Casey. Russian based Mirny. And another Australian base, Davis, and yet another Australian along this coast, it's the Mawson base. Showa base, Japanese base. Here. Then we have Indian base or research station. German base. It's actually located on the ice shelf, Neumayer. And we Halley base, also on the ice shelf. We have the Swedish and Finnish base here, Abua and Vasa, just next to each other. And we have the Norwegian base, two bases here, it's Tor and Troll, nice names. these spaces have all been located close to the coast. But there are actually some stations inland as well. So, right on the South Pole we have the Amundsen Scott base. And then we have the Vostok base. Should be here, probably. And we have, it's also a Russian base, the Vostok. And we have the Kunlun base, Chinese base. Then there are quite a lot of stations on the Antarctic Peninsula. I guess the climate is makes it easier to build and operate from there. So I'm not sure. I can't point out all of them. But maybe the Esperanza, Argentine base, right here at the tip. And the Palmer. Rochera, some other bases. A lot of bases are actually built on small islands just outside the coast. As you can see, there are no bases and stations here. This is Mary Beard land, the only unclaimed land on Antarctica. It's the largest single unclaimed territory on Earth. So I guess it's very, very remote and it's a very hostile environment, inaccessible. But talking about claimed territories, from about 1840 to 1940s, nations have claimed some parts of this continent. But then it was decided that at the Antarctic Treaty that was signed in 1959 that Antarctica should not be like military. Be banned from this continent, and it's a scientific preserve. So these claimed areas are not recognized by all the countries in the world. I guess not so many countries are accepting these, but borders, because it's they're quite common on maps and such. So they all start from the South Pole. It's like pieces of a cake. So biggest area here is the East Antarctica. And it's the Australian Antarctic Territory region. And it goes like this. But then actually it's a French Adélie Land, really narrow piece of land like this. And it was actually the first part was by Dumont d'Urville in 1840, so it's claimed by France. So Adélie Land and Australian Antarctic Territory. And the Australian Antarctic Territory is divided into 9 regions. So it starts here with Enderby Land, Camp Land, MacRobertson Land, Princess Elizabeth Land, William II Land, Queen Mary Land, Wilkes Land, big part here, and on this side of the French part, it's the George V Land and Otis Land. Then we have the Queen Maud Land, that's the Norwegian claim, Antarctica. And let's see, it should be here somewhere. The border. And then we have also like this, this is the Ross dependency, it's this very big ice shelf, the Ross ice shelf, and also some land around it, surrounding it, and this is claimed by New Zealand, and like I said, the Mary Beard land is unclaimed. And then we have this area claimed by Britain and Argentina and Chile. So this is disputed. Or I guess it's all disputed since it's not recognized by all countries. Should use this blue color, I think it's a beautiful color. Maybe the outlines of the ice shelves could be in this color. There's the Larsen shelf. Okay, this was not very accurate. I have drawn some mountains on the ice shelf. That's not possible, I guess. Fimbled ice shelf here. First, I can talk about that later, but I would like to talk about the discovery of this continent and the South Pole in particular. Here's the Amery ice shelf. Ice shelf called West Ice Shelf, but it's on the east. And here's Shackleton Ice Shelf. Yeah. there's a lake I would like to point out. It's close to the Vostok station. It's a subglacial lake, so it's hidden under the glacier. The subglacial lake Vostok. South Pole and the Amundsen Scott base. Amundsen Scott. Here we have the Ross Ice Shelf. Seventh land. And here we have the Mary Beard land. And here we have Victoria Land. Scott. We'll guess that. Davis Bay. boss on bass. Shawma bass. Aitri bass. Hawk on the 7th. C. The reset Larsen. Reset Larsen. Ice shelf. Halley. Bass. The Ronnie. And Phil Schnell. And the Larsen ice shelf, and Alexander the First Island, or just Alexander Island. George the Sixth ice shelf, and this is called the Bellinghausen Sea. That's a small island here, claimed by Norway. Peter the First A. Should be located approximately here. Peter the First. Amundsen Sea, Queen Maud Land, Enderby Land, Elizabethland. Kunlun Station. George the Fifth, Land, Otis, Land, Ellsworth Land, this is the Bay of Whales. The Ross Sea, the Weddell Sea, Weddell Sea, the Berkner Island. So now we have a quite detailed map of Antarctica. And I would like to talk a bit about the discovery and exploring of this continent. So it was the last continent to be discovered by humans, not by penguins. They've been there a long time, and seals and whales, but by humans. And you can see this is the east Antarctica, this is the west, and it makes sense if you're at this part of the South Pole, because then it follows the map we used to see. So here's the Atlantic. Here's Africa, here's the Indian Ocean, here's Terra del Fuego in South America, Cape Horn, and then we have the Pacific, and New Zealand, and Australia. So, for example, in New Zealand, then this is the Ross Dependency of New Zealand, claimed by New Zealand. Then of course west is to in this direction, east is in this direction, just like in New Zealand. So it's a bit confusing with east and west, and north and south as well, but I guess everything is north since This is south. South Pole is the only south. Yeah, so it can be north direction as well. So it's not west. This can be north direction. It's not east. So on. But yeah, it's a very big continent. So it's like the size of US and Mexico combined, approximately. And bigger than Australia, maybe almost twice as big as Australia. And it's very cold. Coldest temperature has been recorded from Vostok, coldest ever on Earth. That was minus 89 degrees Celsius or minus 129 degrees Fahrenheit. And not a surprise that it was recorded here on the east, because this is quite different from the west. This is like a plateau, glacier plateau, really high elevation, like 2,500 meter or 8,200 feet average. And there are actually a lot of mountains that are completely hidden by the ice sheet. And I've heard that it's mountains as high as the Appalachians, but they're not visible, so the ice sheet is even higher, taller. And that makes it, it's a difficult. The air is much thinner and those things, and it's very windy in Antarctica, and so it's cold, it's dry, it's actually a desert, polar desert, the biggest desert in the world, bigger than Sahara Desert, and it's very windy. And then during the summer it's like the sea here, but during winter it's almost double its size with the sea ice added. The ice that's created directly on the sea when the sea's freezing. But then we have these ice shelves, and those never disappear. They're always here, but like I said, they're moving. So they feed from the glaciers, water from all this ice sheet, and they actually push the shelves, the ice shelves, further like this. And then when it got warmer, or for some reason, it ends here, and then the calves, icebergs are created. So it's surrounded by icebergs from these ice shelves. So when you build a station on the ice shelf, I guess after a couple of years it has moved a bit. So I guess those bases, stations, are rebuilt over and over again. And yeah, it's a lot of water stored here. The fresh water is like I've read that it's 90% of the world's ice stored here, and also 70% of the world's fresh water. A lot of ice, a lot of water. was discovered during mostly during the 1800s and 1900s, early 1900s. But you could say it started already in the 1700s, that's the 18th century, with James Cook on his journeys, his expeditions. He was the first who crossed the Antarctic Circle. It goes like this, approximately. So this is north of the circle, but the east coast almost follows the circle like this. So he came from Africa, or the Atlantic here, and in 1773 he was the first to cross the Antarctic Circle, but he didn't reach Antarctica or discovered Antarctica or saw it, but he was really, really close to seeing it, because it was only 120 kilometers or 75 miles from the coast. But he sailed like this to New Zealand, and then like this. Back to the Pacific. So that was maybe the first step, and then we have almost 50 years later, in 1820, there was a Russian expedition with Bellingshausen, and his expedition, he sailed like this from the Atlantic, and they actually caught sight of this part of Antarctica, the Fimbul ice shelf, but they didn't land. But then it was discovered, and then they sailed like this to Sydney, and then back this side, and to Alexander Island. Now, yeah, I don't think he landed there either, so then back to the Atlantic like this. So that was in 1820, and then we have the first documented landing in 1821, but this is a disputed claim, because this time there were a lot of whalers and sealers in this area hunting, and if they found this continent, you could guess that they were keeping it as a secret because a competition. So, but it has been said that John Davis, an American sealer, found Use Bay here on the Antarctic Peninsula in 1821, and that he actually landed there. And then we have another documented landing by Cooper, landing in East Antarctica in 1853 on a mixed whaling sealing voyage. And that would be on the Oates Coast. of Victoria Land. It will be here somewhere. And then we have the French explorer, 1840. Jules de Montorville found this part of the East Coast and the first claim of this part. James Ross as well. Let's see. Yeah, we also have Charles Wilkes sailing like this along the Wilkes Land. So that was in 1839 to 1842. Then I guess this coast was like discovered, but not. They did not land here. The same with the de Montorville. I guess they landed on some islands outside the coast, but they didn't land on the actual continent. Yeah, and then we have the James Ross, 1840 to 1841. Also sailing from Australia and discovering the Ross Sea, named after him, somehow like this. But the first recorded and confirmed landing, even though some of these must have at some point landed at Antarctica, but we have one recorded and confirmed landing on Cape Adare, and that was in 1895 by Norwegian explorer called Karsten Borchgrevink. I have no idea how it's pronounced. And also they built two huts here, so I guess it's the first base ever built on Antarctica. That was in 1898. So this is a historic place, the Cape Adare, for this continent. Today McMurdo is the biggest research station. It has between 200 and 1,000 people working there. I guess 200 during summer, probably, winter probably, and 1,000 during summer. And yeah, and then we have the discovery of the South Pole and the expeditions there. And it was like a race who would be the first to reach this special location on Earth. This was in the early 1900s. And it started with the expedition Discovery in 1901, led by Robert Falcon Scott. And trying to, from this point, Scott base, it's really close to McMurdo Station here. Scott, I guess Scott is was a British station then. Now it's a New Zealand base. McMurdo is a US base. And it started here, and they wanted to first walk on the ice shelf and then cross these mountains and continue on the polar plateau all the way to the South Pole. But I think the first expedition had to stop even before they had crossed the ice shelf, so it was too hard, too long distance for them at this point. But one of those who were in this expedition, Shackleton, Ernest Henry Shackleton, a couple of years later, he was leading another expedition called the Nimrod Expedition, 1907 to 1909. And the first one was they walked for 93 days, so it's almost 3 months, this distance here. So it takes some time actually to walk these conditions. And the next expedition, the Nimrod expeditions, I don't know exactly how many days that was, but I mean for how many days it lasted. But it was also, they didn't reach the South Pole. They reached some place. This time they crossed the mountains, and so they were the first to discover this plateau and step on this glacial plateau. They realize they have to turn back because they didn't have enough food or something like that. So it was like you could either go to the South Pole and die, or you could go back home and survive. And but it was a new record to be on the most southern steps on Earth. No one had been this south on Earth before. And then we have the famous race to the South Pole in 1911-1912. So it started with Scott again. He and four other men were going from the same place here, Scott base, and they should cross these mountains at the Beardmore Glacier here somewhere and continue on the plateau to the south pole and then back again. But then when they had already started, the Norwegian explorer Amundsen, Roald Amundsen, wanted to also to be the first to reach the South Pole. So he made this become a race, first to the South Pole at the same time as Scott and his men were trying. But Amundsen started from this place, Bay of Whales, and it was actually a bit shorter distance. On this map it doesn't seem like that, but it was a bit shorter, and they would cross the mountains at the Axel Heiberg Glacier instead of the Beardmore Glacier. And Amundsen had a lot of practice, been to the Arctic, many expeditions in the Arctic, and learned how to have a dogs pulling the sledges and such things, and also what clothes is best to wear in these conditions. So it wasn't too difficult for them to reach the South Pole and return, while Scott's team, they were suffering a lot. They started with some tractors that just broke down quite immediately, and they had ponies that were freezing so much, and they had to, yeah, I guess they didn't survive for so long, and dogs, and yeah, it was really, they suffered a lot, I guess, but actually they did reach the South Pole, but a couple of weeks after Amundsen, and they didn't make it on the way back. So here somewhere they all died, and one of them was called Oates, I guess. He's given the name to the Oates land here, and Scott base, of course, and Amundsen Scott, the base on the South. Suffered. They were actually walking, and they were also pulling the sledges themselves, because all their, like their horses and their dogs, and hadn't make it. But yes, which it was quite a disaster, I guess. Research about Antarctica, because I didn't know much, I have to admit. It's just something you see on the world maps, like at the very bottom of the map, some white and grey shape here. I didn't realize the shape, the actual shape of it. If you're not looking at the types of Antarctic maps or on a globe. This part, the western part, is not, the elevation is not as high as here. So it's not as much ice and water stored here. Thank you so much for watching, and